Hello guys, welcome to the course in Organic Made Easy. This is a course that we are putting up for students of class 11th and 12th preparing for JEE and NEET so that we can help you study inorganic chemistry in a real easy way. And in this series, the lecture for today is going to be on the thermal decomposition reactions. This is the fourth lecture that we are putting for the thermal decomposition reactions. We've already put the lectures on the thermal decomposition of metal carbonates, bicarbonates, hydroxides. We've already taken up a lecture on the heating effects of the thermal decomposition reactions of the ammonium salts, which is going to be very important for the learning of reactions for the preparation of nitrogen and ammonia. Very, very important because that really frequently coming in the examination. Then we've already taken up a lecture on the heating effects on the metal nitrates, again very important for you people. And today we are going to talk about the heating of the thermal decomposition of metal sulfates. Again, this will be really very important, very helpful to you people, and I hope you are going to enjoy the learning because we are trying it to make it as simple as possible. Less number of reactions you have to learn and you master all the thermal decomposition reactions. That is what our motto is over here. So I hope you will enjoy your learning with me. I am Dr. Ritu Johar, your educator from the channel H2O, the A to Z of chemistry. So let us begin the learning. So all those who have watched my previous lectures on the thermal decomposition reactions, they know what is thermal decomposition. For those who do not, let us quickly see what is thermal decomposition first of all. So thermal decomposition, this is going to be a type of chemical reaction where we will be heating a substance and it is going to be breaking down into two or more products. For example, if I take the example of lithium nitrate, when we are going to heat it, it is going to give us lithium oxide, NO2 gas and oxygen gas. So here what is happening? What is happening is that we have taken just one reactant. Remember, it is just one reactant and we are heating it and we are seeing what are the products being formed. Another very important thing that you have to remember is that we are heating. What is happening over here is that we are supplying energy to cause the overcoming of the bond strength between the reactant atoms. Therefore, in all these reactions, you will be seeing that these reactions, they are endothermic reactions. Energy has to be supplied to break the bonds present in between the atoms, right? And the next thing, here, this is going to be thermal decomposition reaction. So the energy to break the bonds is going to be supplied in the form of heat. Now we come up to thermal decomposition of metal sulfates. And to make the learning simple, what we will be doing is, as we have been doing in the previous lectures also, classifying the metals into three types. So this is going to be very helpful to you by classifying the metals into three types. What we do is we learn just one type of reaction for a particular type and we know what is going to be happening to all the metals that is present in that type. All right. So here we are going to divide first of all the metals into three classes, class 1, class 2, class 3. And for those who have already watched the lectures on metal carbonates, the metal hydroxides, the metal nitrates, we have classified the metals in the same way. So you are learning the all decomposition reactions by dividing the metals into three classes and then just learning the decomposition reactions for them. It really makes the study very easy. So class 1, this is going to consist of all the group 1 metals. That is the alkali metals, but except lithium. That is very important. Lithium is not going to be into this class. Lithium, if you all remember, this has anomalous properties. It resembles magnesium in its properties. So what we will be doing is we will be putting lithium into class 2 with all other metals of group 2. Right. So we have beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium placed in class 2. Along with that, we have the D block elements. We have the P block metals also placed in class 2. what you have to remember here is all the metals which are in class 1, all right, all the metals which are in class 3, if you remember those, and then the rest are all going to be in class 2. So what is now in class 3? Class 3 we have silver and mercury. So class 1 is group 1 metals except lithium. Class 3 is silver and mercury, and all the rest of the metals we will be putting in class 2. Do remember that gold and platinum, they are noble metals, so they will not be put into any of these classifications. They generally do not form salts, so we do not study about their decomposition reactions. If they will be forming any salts, we will be putting them along with silver and mercury into class 3. The products of their decomposition reactions will be the same as we have for silver and mercury. Now, to remember these three classes, there is a trick, and the trick is that you all know about the activity series of the metals, which you have learned in your junior classes, right? I hope so. You remember that the activity series, starting from potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, tin, lead, hydrogen, copper, mercury, silver, right? So this is how the metals, they decrease their reactivity according to the activity series. And you must have learned some mnemonic also to remember the activity series. If you have not, you can see this and you can memorize it. If you have already learned it, please do carry on. My motive is how to remember these three classes with the help of these activity series. So sodium and potassium, you can see on the top. This is going to form the class 1 metals along with the rest of the alkali metals except lithium. So this is how you can remember the first two. They are class 1 along with the rest of the alkali metals except lithium. And then the top, go to the bottom. The bottom we have mercury and silver, right? And similarly, if you write the complete list, it will be gold and platinum also. So you can just remember the last ones. So we have mercury and silver over here forming the class 3 metals, and the rest, all of the metals in between, they will be forming the class 2 metals. Perfectly fine. No problem. Great. So now what are going to be the thermal decomposition products for the various metal sulfates? Let us learn them one by one, class by class. So first we have is the class 1 metal sulfates. So class 1 metal sulfates are going to be what? The group 1 metals except lithium, their sulfates, they are in the class 1, right? So how are they going to decompose? Let us see that. Well, the class 1 metal sulfates, they are stable to heat. They are not going to decompose, just like what you have done for the carbonates, just like that what you have done for the hydroxides also, right? So the metal sulfates of class 1, they do not decompose on heating. For example, if somebody asks you what is going to be the product for the decomposition of sodium sulfate, there is going to be no product that is formed. Then we have potassium sulfate, again no decomposition taking place. Similarly, rubidium and cesium sulfate, no decomposition taking place. Now let us see the class 2 metal sulfates. So the class 2 metal sulfates, they are going to decompose on heating, forming metal oxide and sulfur trioxide gases. This is just similar to what we have already learned for the carbonates, we have already learned for the hydroxides, the same fashion. The oxide is going to be formed, and along with that, what is being formed? Well, along with that, a gas is being formed. In case of the carbonates, it was carbon dioxide. In case of the hydroxides, it was water that was being formed. And in case of the sulfates, sulfur trioxide is being formed. So this is going to be really very simple. Once you just know this very simple little trick of dividing the metals into these three classes and learning the corresponding salts for them. So for example, we have lithium sulfate forming lithium oxide and SO3. magnesium sulfate forming magnesium oxide and sulfur trioxide. We have zinc sulfate forming zinc oxide, sulfur trioxide. Same way we are going to have it for copper sulfate, lead sulfate, and as well as for ferric sulfate, the common reactions which are going to be used by you people in your various studies of inorganic chemistry. Now, one very important exception we have is as ferrous sulfate, right? So ferric sulfate on heating was giving us ferric oxide and along with that sulfur trioxide, and ferrous sulfate is giving us ferric oxide and along with that sulfur trioxide and along with that sulfur dioxide also. Now the question is, how are you going to remember this? These ones, they are similar, so it is going to be easy for you to remember. But how will you remember this? And this is a very important reaction, a very frequently asked reaction. So you have to obviously remember it. And there are going to be certain more exceptional reactions that you have to learn. So how are you going to remember them? Well, here I am teaching you inorganic made easy. So obviously, I'm going to make it easy for you. Do not worry about that. But before I move on further, there is one very important thing related to SO3 that you have to remember. When the temperature is going to be below 800 degrees Celsius, well, sulfur trioxide is sulfur trioxide. But the moment the temperature becomes greater than 800 degrees Celsius, even sulfur trioxide is going to decompose to give a sulfur dioxide and along with that oxygen. So there is going to be a change in the products if the temperature will be 800 degrees Celsius or more. We will be getting metal oxide, sulfur dioxide and oxygen. So just remember this one small little thing and then we will be learning how to remember this exceptional reaction. So now how will we remember this reaction? Ferrosulfate on heating, this will decompose to give us ferric oxide, sulfur dioxide and sulfur trioxide. So I just want you to go back to the previous reactions that you just now learned. The reaction of lead sulfate forming lead oxide and sulfur trioxide. Similarly, ferric sulfate forming Fe2O3 and sulfur trioxide. In both of these reactions, what you will be able to see is the oxidation state of the metals that remains the same. In case of lead sulfate, we have the oxidation of lead to be +2. And in case of lead oxide, the oxidation state is again +2. Similarly, in case of ferric sulfate also, you will see that the iron is in +3 oxidation state in both sulfate as well as oxide. But when we come up to the reaction that we have to learn for ferrous sulfate, there is going to be a change in oxidation state. So we have the ferrous ions in +2 oxidation state and here we have ferric oxide. So this is +3 oxidation state. There is a change in oxidation state and this is going to be helping us even to remember the products. So what is going to be the trick? The trick is write the first reaction the way you have written all these reactions. We will be first of all forming ferrous oxide and sulfur trioxide as the decomposition reaction of ferrous sulfate, right? So the corresponding +2, +2. No change in the oxidation state. That will be the reaction that you will be writing. But now you all know that FeO has iron in +2 oxidation state. It can still be oxidized. And sulfur trioxide, sulfur is in its highest oxidation state +6. So this can come to a lower oxidation state. It can be still reduced, right? And when we have one of the substance which can get oxidized, it will be acting as the reducing agent, and the one which can be reduced, it will be acting as the oxidizing agent, and then the reaction is going to proceed further for them. So far what we have seen is that the trick says that just write the product for ferrous sulfate also, just like we do for the rest of the reaction, giving us ferrous oxide and sulfur trioxide. But ferrous oxide. Iron is in plus 2 oxidation state. It can be oxidized further, so this will be acting as a reducing agent. And sulfur trioxide, sulfur is in plus 6 oxidation state. It can reduce its oxidation number, so this will be acting as the oxidizing agent. Both of them therefore will be undergoing a redox reaction, and what we will be seeing the product form is Fe2O3 plus sulfur dioxide. So iron from plus 2 goes into plus 3 oxide, and sulfur trioxide, sulfur from plus 6 will be going to plus 4 oxidation state in sulfur dioxide. Now I hope this is clear first of all. Alright, so next what you are going to do is multiply the first equation by 2, because in the second equation you can see 2 FeO. So we will be just cancelling this out, 2 FeO and 2 FeO this side, and the net balanced reaction that you will be getting is 2 FeSO4. Then you have Fe2O3 1, right? Sulfur dioxide 1, and sulfur trioxide, this side it was 1 and this side it is 2. So the net total is going to be 1 sulfur trioxide. So this is what you will be getting as the net reaction, and this is what we have as the products for ferrous sulfate. I hope now you will remember this, and if you forget it also, you will be able to remember the trick and write down the products. So let us see some similar example of chromium sulfate giving us chromic oxide plus sulfur dioxide and sulfur trioxide. So in chromium sulfate, you will be seeing that chromium is in plus 2 oxidation state and chromic oxide, it is a plus 3 oxidation state. So this is just similar to what we have done for iron. So again, you can apply the same trick and remember the products for this reaction as well, just like you did for ferrous sulfate, exactly same. Next, one more example I have is for the heating of tin sulfate now, right? So this is stannous sulfate, because here tin is in the plus 2 oxidation state, and again tin can go up to a higher oxidation state of plus 4. So we will be seeing SnO2 over here, and along with that the product that is formed is sulfur dioxide. Now here sulfur trioxide is not getting formed. So again, how are you going to remember it? Just do it exactly the same way, right? So tin sulfate plus 2 oxidation state. So make the oxide also in plus 2 oxidation state, and along with that make sulfur trioxide. So here tin is in plus 2, here it is in plus 2, and sulfur is in plus 6. So tin again can go up to the plus 4 oxidation state, so it is going to act as the reducing agent. Sulfur trioxide, sulfur is in plus 6 oxidation state, it can come down, so it will be acting as the oxidizing agent. Both of them, they are going to react with each other, and what we will be getting is the oxide of tin in the higher oxidation state, and sulfur dioxide, sulfur going into its lower oxidation state as sulfur dioxide. Right, but now when you are going to add up this, you can see that this is already a balanced reaction, so you do not have to multiply the first equation by anything. Simply SnO and SnO, they are going to cancel on this side, and also SO3 and SO3 also will be cancelling out. So what you will be getting as the total product is this, right? So stannous sulfate on heating will be giving you stannic oxide, and along with that sulfur dioxide. So you do not have to muck this up, you just understand it and you are going to do awesomely well, right? So when you're going to see that there is a possibility of the metal to go to a higher oxidation state, this is how you are going to just write down the products. Remember one more thing over here, associated thing, that stannic oxide, this is also known as the cassiterite ore, the most common ore for tin. Okay, so this is something related, so I just wanted you to remember that. Now in the class 2 metal sulfates, one very important thing that you have to remember is going to be the heating effects on the hydrated sulfates. Very frequently it is these questions that will be coming in your examination. Alright, so for example, if we have copper sulfate 5H2O, so this is the hydrated salt of copper sulfate, and this is called as commonly blue vitriol because it is blue in color. I'll just now show you the color also, but this is going to be blue color. When it is going to be exposed to sunlight, it is going to lose 2 water molecules and it is going to become bluish white in color. But if you are going to heat it to a temperature of 100 degrees Celsius, it is going to lose 2 further molecules of water and it is going to be copper sulfate.H2O, and this will become white in color now. Okay, and if you're going to still further heat it to a temperature of 220 degrees Celsius, it will become anhydrous copper sulfate, no water molecule left. This will be also white in color. If we are going to heat it further to a maximum of around 700 degrees Celsius, you will be seeing that copper sulfate is also breaking down into copper oxide and sulfur trioxide. So this is what we have already learned, that when we have copper sulfate, this is a class 2 metal, so its sulfate on heating will give us copper oxide and sulfur trioxide. But if we are going to heat this at a temperature greater than 800 degrees Celsius, so sulfur trioxide also breaks down into sulfur dioxide and oxygen. So the net product will be copper oxide, sulfur dioxide and oxygen, and copper oxide, this is going to be a black colored residue. Okay, so this is what you have to remember for the hydrated copper sulfate salt. Let me show you the color also. So this is copper sulfate 5H2O, bluish in color. That is why it is called as blue vitriol. And when we are going to heat it, it starts losing its blue color, and the anhydrous copper sulfate, this is white color. So you can see very beautifully the color changing from blue to white. Okay, so I hope you will remember this. One very important thing I'm going to just now tell you about it, and this will even help you remember how these water molecules, they are going to be lost as well. So how do you remember that copper sulfate 5H2O will be losing first of all 2 water molecules, then 2 more and 1 more? Well, the answer lies in the structure of copper sulfate 5H2O that you will be learning in detail when you will be learning about coordination compounds. I will just briefly talk about how you are going to remember this. Otherwise, when you will be learning it in coordination chemistry, you will be able to appreciate it more. So what happens over here is that we have 5 water molecules, out of which 4 water molecules, they get associated with the copper ions by formation of coordinate bonds. So water, oxygen has lone pair. It is going to be donating that to the copper ions, forming a coordinate bond. Okay, so 4 water molecules form a coordinate bond with the copper ions, and 1 water molecule, this is going to form a hydrogen bond with the sulfate ions. So these are the 5 water molecules, 4 coordinated and 1 hydrogen bonded. Okay, now out of this, just if looking at the picture, what you can remember this way is that these 2 water molecules, they are towards outside. We can lose them easily. So on exposure to sunlight, 2 water molecules gone. Then you can see that these 2 water molecules, they are towards inside. So they are not that easy to be removed. So we heat it at a temperature of 100 degrees Celsius. So they also get removed. Now this hydrogen bonded water molecule, you can see it is attached this side, and it is going to be attached. And this becomes quite inside into the lattice of the structure. Okay, so into the crystal lattice, this becomes deeply seated inside. Therefore, it is very difficult to lose this, and that is why we have to heat it at a higher temperature. All right, so 2 outside go first, then 2 inside go next, and then the 5th one goes the next. Okay, so sunlight 100 degrees Celsius, 220 degrees Celsius, and then we get the anhydrous copper sulfate. Right, perfectly clear, no problems. And then you know that if you are going to heat it, copper sulfate anhydrous, you will be getting copper oxide plus sulfur trioxide. But if you are going to heat it at a temperature of greater than 800 degrees Celsius, it will be breaking down into sulfur dioxide and oxygen. Perfectly fine. I hope no confusions, and you will be able to remember this, because this is very important for you people to remember. Okay. Now the next we move on to another structure again, which is very important, and that is ferrous sulfate 7H2O. Although the major thing we have already done, that we have ferrous sulfate 7H2O, when we are going to heat it at a temperature of 300 degrees Celsius, what you will be seeing is the loss of the 7 water molecules. And then when you're going to heat it further, what you will be getting is ferric oxide, sulfur dioxide and sulfur trioxide. How we are getting this is what you have already learned. Perfectly fine. And then we have ferric sulfate. Ferric sulfate is going to give us ferric oxide, and along with that, sulfur trioxide. Perfectly fine, no difficulty. Let me show you the structure of green vitriol. So this is green vitriol, ferrous sulfate 7H2O, the beautiful green colored crystals. And when we are going to heat it, what are we forming? We are forming ferric oxide. This is going to be a reddish brown color powder. Okay, so this is what you can remember. Just looking at the salts, the residues, you are going to remember it better, I'm sure. The next very important hydrated sulfate that we have to learn is calcium sulfate 2H2O, which we call as gypsum. This is a hard solid mass. Okay, this is a hard solid porous mass that you have to remember. And when we are going to heat it to a temperature of 120 degrees Celsius, there is going to be a loss of 1.5 water molecule per molecule. And what we will be getting is calcium sulfate half H2O. Chemical name will become calcium sulfate hemihydrate. This is calcium sulfate dihydrate. Two water molecules dihydrate, half a water molecule hemihydrate, and the common name is plaster of Paris. In short, we call it as POP. POP. Okay. And where it is used, if you people have seen anybody with a fracture and he has a bandage on it, which is, you generally call it as a plaster, right? So what has happened? He got fractured and he is now having his arm plastered. So what has happened over here is that they take some bandage. To that, they apply this plaster of Paris as a paste, add water to it, and then after some time that gets set into a hard porous mass again, which becomes gypsum. Okay, so this is what we have as gypsum. This was a powder which to what you have added some water, and what you get back is a set plaster which we call as gypsum. Okay, so again, if you're going to heat this, you will be getting plaster of Paris back again if you heat it at a temperature of 120 degrees Celsius. But if you're going to heat it to a higher temperature, say of 200 degrees Celsius, even this half water molecule will be lost. And what we will be getting is only calcium sulfate, the anhydrous calcium sulfate salt. Okay, and this is called as dead burnt plaster. Why we call it as dead burnt plaster? Because now to this, if you're going to add water also, well, we will not be getting back gypsum. It is not going to set. So you can also remember this, that this calcium sulfate anhydrous, this is no setting plaster. It will not set into a solid mass even when you're going to add water to it. Okay, so this is a no setting plaster, whereas POP, this is a setting plaster. When you are going to add water to this, you will be getting back calcium sulfate 2H2O. When you are going to heat it to a temperature of 120 degrees Celsius, you get POP. Okay, I hope now you will remember this. This is very important. And this is what you learn in class 11, S block elements, group 2, special compounds. Now, the next hydrated salt that you have to learn is about zinc sulfate 7H2O. When you're going to heat it to a temperature of 70 degrees Celsius, one water molecule lost. When we are going to heat it up till a temperature of 200 degrees Celsius, five more lost, only one will be left. Heat it to a temperature greater than 200 degrees Celsius, zinc sulfate form. When you're going to heat it further, first of all, sulfur trioxide, and then if we go beyond 800 degrees Celsius, the final product is going to be the oxide, sulfur dioxide, and half water oxygen molecule. Okay, so I hope now this will be clear. What you have to remember is obviously these temperature ranges where the water molecules are being lost. Another important one, which is just similar to zinc sulfate, is magnesium sulfate 7H2O. This is called as the Epsom salt. The same products will be formed just as we have in case of zinc sulfate 7H2O, because both of these, they have same type of crystal structure. And when we have compounds having same type of crystal structure, they are called as isomorphous, right? So what is isomorphism? Compounds having similar molecular formula and identical crystal structure, they are called as isomorphous. So zinc sulfate 7H2 and magnesium sulfate 7H2O, they are isomorphous. Therefore, the heating effects are also going to be just similar to each other. Okay, so this is what you will be remembering. So the next we have is the class 3 metal sulfates. So class 3 metal sulfates, which were the metals? It was silver and mercury, right? So when they are going to be heated, they are going to decompose to give us metal, oxygen and sulfur trioxide. So here why it is metal and oxygen? Why you have to remember is that in these class 3 metals, the metal oxide that is being formed, this is unstable. So essentially, first a metal oxide and sulfur trioxide is formed, just like the class 2 metal sulfates. But then this metal oxide breaks down further on heating to give us metal and oxygen. Okay, so what we will be getting in case of silver sulfate is metal, oxygen and sulfur trioxide. And similarly for mercury also, metal, oxygen and sulfur trioxide. This is what you have to remember. Now, one more thing before I just finish this off. Ammonium sulfate. So ammonium sulfate is also one cation that we have in association with the same anion. Although I have taken up a separate lecture for the ammonium salts, you have to watch that lecture to remember what are going to be the products formed over here. But just for your information, it is going to be ammonia and H2SO4. And if you're going to heat it to a very high temperature, even H2SO4, this is going to decompose to give us water and sulfur trioxide. So the products will be ammonia, water and sulfur trioxide. This will be on very strong heating, so no residue will be left. Everything is going to escape into the atmosphere. Awesome. So now it is going to be time to see a few questions based upon what we have learned. I would request you all, first of all, to try the question yourself and then look at the solution. So the first question is, when gypsum is heated to 393 Kelvin, it forms calcium sulfate 0.5H2O, calcium sulfate 5H2O, dead burnt plaster, anhydrous calcium sulfate, and this is a JE Mains 2020 question. Right, so I hope you understand the importance of what we have discussed today. All right, so please do try it and then we are going to check the answer. The correct answer to this question is A choice. What we have learned is that calcium sulfate 2H2O, this is calcium sulfate dihydrate. Then we are going to heat it at a temperature of 120 degrees Celsius, which is nothing but 393 Kelvin. All right, so we will be getting calcium sulfate half H2O or 0.5H2O, right? So calcium sulfate 5H2O, it is not there. We have only calcium sulfate 2H2O. Dead burnt plaster and anhydrous calcium sulfate, they are one and the same thing, but this will be formed only when we are going to heat it at a temperature greater than 200 degrees Celsius. So the next question that we have is copper sulfate 5H2O on a heating of 1000 degrees Celsius gives A plus B plus ca oxygen. Copper sulfate H2O in presence of this X is going to give us copper sulfate. The correct options you have to choose. A can be copper sulfate, A can be copper oxide. B can be sulfur dioxide and X can be 230 degrees Celsius. And this is going to be a multi-correct question. So you have to choose the options which can be correct over here. So think, attempt, and then we will be discussing it. So the correct reaction that you all know for copper sulfate 5H2O heating is that when we are going to heat it at a temperature of greater than 800 degrees Celsius, which over here is a temperature of 1000 degrees Celsius. So what we will be getting is copper oxide and sulfur dioxide and oxygen. So sulfur trioxide has broken up into sulfur dioxide and oxygen at a temperature greater than 800 degrees Celsius. And when it is said copper sulfate H2O, is going to give us copper sulfate, what we have learned is at a temperature of 220 degrees Celsius, what we will be getting is the removal of this water molecule also to get copper sulfate, right? So what this means is A over here, it can be copper oxide. Okay, so what we are getting at 1000 degrees Celsius is copper oxide, sulfur dioxide and oxygen. So A is going to be copper oxide, B is going to be sulfur dioxide and X, it is 230 degrees Celsius, which is a temperature almost comparable to 220 degrees Celsius. So this is also going to be correct. So the correct options are going to be B, C and D. The next question is, when green vitriol, that is FeSO4 7H2O, is heated, the products are, and you all I hope know what is the correct answer. I do not think that anybody is going to get that wrong. The correct option is going to be D choice, because FeSO4 7H2O on heating is going to give us Fe2O3 plus sulfur dioxide and SO3. Okay, so I hope it is clear. Now the next question is, in solid copper sulfate 5H2O, copper ions is coordinate bonded to water molecules. One water molecule is hydrogen bonded. It has four types of bonding: ionic, covalent, hydrogen and coordinate. Five molecules are water. They are coordinate bonded to the copper ions. Again, this is going to be a multi-correct question. So multi-correct option question. So more than one choices, they are going to be correct. So please choose the options wisely. If you haven't done it, well, the correct answer is going to be A, B, C. All the three are going to be correct. Only D option is incorrect. So copper ions, they are forming coordinate bonds with four water molecules. Therefore, A option is correct. One water molecule is forming hydrogen bonds with the sulfate ions. So that is also going to be correct. It has four types of bonding. Between the copper water complex and the sulfate ions, the bond that we are seeing is an ionic bond. So copper plus 2, sulfate minus 2, this is an ionic bond, right? In the sulfate ions, between sulfur and oxygen, there are going to be covalent bonds present. In water molecule, between oxygen and hydrogen, covalent bonds are present. So we have covalent bonds also. Just now what we said was sulfate ion is forming a hydrogen bond with one water molecule. So hydrogen bonding is also present, and coordinate bonds between copper ions and the four water molecules are formed. So it has all four types of bonding. So this is also going to be correct. And then the five molecules of water, they are coordinate bonded to copper. No, only four are coordinate bonded. One is going to be forming a hydrogen bond. So D option is going to be incorrect. Okay. So next question, this is the last question for today, and this is the JEE Mains 2019 question. A hydrated solid X on heating initially, this gives a monohydrated compound Y. Y on heating above 373 Kelvin, which is 100 degrees Celsius. Please do remember, because we are talking the temperatures in Celsius and here it is coming in Kelvin, so do not get confused. So Y on heating above 373 Kelvin leads to an anhydrous white powder Z. X and Z, they are respectively baking soda and dead burnt plaster, washing soda and soda ash, washing soda and dead burnt plaster, baking soda and soda ash. Okay, so first of all, baking soda is sodium bicarbonate. We have not studied in this lecture, but this is something related because we are studying dead burnt plaster in this lecture. So I just thought of putting this question. It is going to be important. And anyways, we are learning the thermal decomposition reaction. So this is going to be one more thermal decomposition reaction that you are going to learn today. Dead burnt plaster is what? Anhydrous calcium sulfate. Okay, washing soda. This is sodium carbonate 10H2O, sodium carbonate with 10 water molecules as water of crystallization. Soda ash is going to be the anhydrous form of sodium carbonate. So when we are going to remove the 10 water molecules from sodium carbonate 10H2O, just let me write that down. So it is going to be Na2CO3.10H2O. This is washing soda. When we are going to dehydrate it, these 10 water molecules, they go, what we will be getting is soda ash. Okay. And then we have another option as washing soda and dead burnt plaster, baking soda and soda ash. Okay. So we are heating a solid initially to give a monohydrated compound, and then heating it above 100 degrees Celsius, we get another hydrous white compound. So what you have learned as far as calcium sulfate 2H2O was that when you were heating it at a temperature of 200 degrees Celsius, what you were getting was the anhydrous compound. 120 degrees Celsius, we got calcium sulfate hemihydrate, that was POP. It was at 200 degrees Celsius that we got the anhydrous calcium sulfate. So this means that it cannot be dead burnt plaster. First of all, that should be very clear to you. So it cannot be dead blood plaster. It has to be soda ash. So what is going to be that solid which on heating is going to give us at a temperature of 100 degrees Celsius or 373 Kelvin? Soda ash, it is going to be washing soda. So washing soda, sodium carbonate 10H2 at a temperature of 100 degrees Celsius is going to give us sodium carbonate, okay, which is called as soda ash. Therefore, the correct answer is going to be B choice. So you have learned another hydrated salt decomposition, this time a carbonate also. But I'm just trying to give you the best possible information so that you can attempt your examination really well. So that would be all for this lecture. I hope you enjoyed this learning with me. You will remember these very important reactions, not forget them, all of them. They are very, very, very important. Please do remember them well. See you again for another lecture, some more tricks, some more concepts, some more important questions. Please do subscribe to the channel so that you get the notification whenever we are putting up the lectures for you, because we are really doing hard work so that you can succeed. So see you again. Have a nice day. God bless you.